Thank you.
Hey.
Thank you again.
No. Thank you.
We're gonna ride our bicycle.
So he must have run away knowing that you're coming to pick him up.
Hello. That surprised me with interest, and for that, I thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Come it on.
Hello and welcome to On Hold with Atchka. I'm your host, Shannon. Today we have a very interesting interview for parents or anyone that's interested in the childhood obesity epidemic. We speak with Ellyn Satter, who's a specialist, a nutritionist, who has got some great advice on feeding strategies for children. So I hope you enjoy today's interview.
Okay.
I'm speaking with Ellyn Satter, a nutritionist, who wrote Your Child's Weight, Helping Without Harming, as well as many other books on nutrition and feeding strategies for children. That could also be easily applied to adults. So first of all, I just want to tell you, I adore your book. After I read it, there's two books that I recommend regularly, and one is Health at Every Size by Dr. Linda Bacon, and the other is your book. It's outstanding. It's reassuring for parents. It's just a wonderful book. So thank
Shannon,
you.
Shannon, which one of my books are you talking about? Secrets or
Both, actually. Secrets of Feeding Your Family and Your Child's
uh-huh.
Weight. Both of them were
uh-huh.
excellent books.
That's great. I'm so glad to hear that. And you can tell my politics are really health at every size.
Mm-hmm. And that's what I kind of thought was, it seems like Your Child's Weight was almost like health at every size for kids.
Oh, absolutely. That's right. That's right. Definitely. And the philosophy that I have for children is that you want them to grow up to be competent eaters.
Mm-hmm.
That is, you want to preserve their ability to regulate their food intake, that is to go by their internal feelings of hunger and fullness to eat as much as they need.
Mm-hmm.
And when they do that, they're going to grow up to get the body that is right for them, that is, as bigger, as small as their genetics dictates for them. And then they'll also grow up taking an interest in food and enjoying eating and learning to like the food that their grown-ups eat. And so, and if you've read Secrets of Feeding a Healthy Family, you've read about the research that we've done with eating competence for adults. And, that really puts an extremely solid research foundation under health at every size.
Mm-hmm. In Your Child's Health, Your Child's Weight, you basically discuss a comprehensive feeding strategy that deals with a wide variety of mealtime issues that parents may encounter,
uh-huh.
including, both having a large or small child that you may be concerned with or having a large and small appetite. And in a way, it's a prescription for the quote-unquote childhood obesity epidemic. Most of your feeding strategies are predicated on trust, parents trusting kids to eat correctly for themselves and kids trusting parents to provide them for regular meals. So I guess the first thing I want to ask is, this is a very, it's kind of a leap of faith strategy. Why should people trust you?
Why should people trust me?
Yes. Why? It's a very counterintuitive. The advice you give is
mm-hmm.
it runs counter to everything we hear in the media right now. So why should people trust your strategy, your evidence, your experience? I just want to set down a baseline for people to understand where you're coming
yeah.
from.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you're asking that, because when I wrote my first book, I asked myself the same question. Why should parents trust what I have to say? And this was Child of Mine, Feeding with Love and Good Sense, the first edition back in 1983. And the reason I ask that is that there's so darn much opinion
mm-hmm.
out there that everybody who's ever raised a child or been a child has an opinion about how it's supposed to work. And so, I said, well, I'm not going to expect parents to simply accept my opinions. I want them, this is going to be research-based. And if it's not research-based, it's going to be based on my very careful clinical observation and also observations coming out of raising my own kids. I have three grown children, all sort of hovering around age 40, and a number of grandchildren. And so, you know, a lot of what of my hypotheses that I developed about feeding kids, I developed in raising my own kids. I'd try something and it wouldn't work, or I'd, you know, observe what went on with them. And then I work with people clinically. I worked as a registered dietitian in a pediatric clinic for many years, and I'd talk with parents and we'd work out solutions to problems. And so, and sort of between, about the time that Child of Mine was being published, which was 1983, there started to be some good research on feeding dynamics, that people actually observed groups of children and observed how they ate and what allowed them to learn to like new food and how they behaved with respect to food regulation. And so, you know, then I could get some research backing for what I was, my sort of observational advice. And I do have to tell you, I held my breath the first few of those studies I read, because I was thinking, I was afraid that, you know, my advice would be totally off base. But it wasn't. I mean, I'm a good clinical observer, and I'm very good at giving up on my pet hypotheses and revising them if they seem not to be working, which, by the way, Shannon, as you know, is something that people working with the conventional model of overweight are absolutely not able to do.
That is very true.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I mean, they just keep wailing away at this weight reduction thing when it's been proven over and over and over again that it doesn't work. So anyway, that's why, you know, parents trust me. And parents also trust me because they are skeptical of what I have to say, but their backs are to the wall. What they're doing isn't working. You know, feeding is awful, and, you know, their kids are unhappy, and they're unhappy. And they, as one of my correspondents said the other day, well, I just was going to prove to them that they were wrong, that this wasn't going to work. And so I did it, and it worked. And by it, I mean establishing a division of responsibility in feeding, which I think you can recapitulate as well as I can.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we've been using it with our daughters and my son as well. Although it's harder, I got to tell you, it's a lot easier to allow our big eater to kind of regulate herself. She does, and she mostly eats vegetables and fruit. She loves them. It's harder though with our little waif, who barely eats anything. It's so hard to like let her not eat.
I know it.
And not comment on it, and not try and encourage her to eat more.
It really is, isn't it? I mean, anytime children are kind of at the extremes, and you know, you handle the extreme of your big eater well, but it seems like the other extreme is worrisome for you.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I mean, it's such a natural parental tendency to kind of nudge children a little bit to get them back toward the middle.
Mm-hmm.
And you know perfectly well that in the long run, if you start to do that, that she'll eat worse, not better.
Right. And that's, well, what do you do if you have a child who, if given the choice, will only eat the tasty, nutritionally questionable foods rather than vegetables if you put them on a plate together?
Well, if you're putting them on the plate together, you simply have to accept whatever happens.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're getting into the topic of so-called forbidden food.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it is the parent's job to see to it that a child doesn't have an unrelieved diet of sweets and chips.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to sort of, you know, if you're in the position where you can do this, and you know, many families, their backs are to the wall economically in terms of their resources, and so they do what they can with respect to feeding their kids, but or choosing food for their kids. But you know, if you're in a position to have control of your menus, there are ways of managing these so-called forbidden foods. So your child, so you're doing as much as you can to help your child to eat a positive variety of food. So let me be more specific. Generally, this conversation starts with people asking what to do about desserts. And if they've read my stuff, they know about my dessert recommendation, which is put a single serving of the dessert on the table and let at the, each person's plate on the table, a single serving, and let the child eat it and yourself eat it when you want, before, during, or after the meal. And then, but once that single serving is gone, that's it. No seconds, no re-ups on the dessert. And the reason I recommend that is children will push themselves along to learn and grow, but they'll also take the easy way out if it's offered. Which, and certainly a cookie is the easy way out when the choice is learning to like a new vegetable, which could take 15 or 20 trials, or a cookie, which typically involves one trial learning. And so you really don't want your child to fill up on cookies when there are other options. You know, you want to encourage them to kind of sneak up on those vegetables and learn to like them. However, in doing that, you know, the single serving of dessert rule violates the division of responsibility in feeding and creates scarcity. You know, it sort of sets up cookies as forbidden food and therefore more desirable. And so you have to sort of correct that. You have to neutralize this feeling of scarcity. And the time to do that is at snack time. And so, you know, every so often at snack time, put on a big plate of cookies and some milk and let your child eat as many cookies as she wants. And, you know, and if you haven't been in the habit of doing this, at first your child will eat like there's no tomorrow. But, you know, the newness will wear off, and she will get, so she, you know, gets to the point where she just eats a few cookies and goes off and, you know, kind of leaves. I mean, it's not a big deal anymore. Chips are easier because they tend not to compete with the other nutritious food at the meal. And so putting on a big bowl of chips, enough to go around and have some left over every so often along with the sandwiches, is a good idea. And that way everybody can eat their fill, and it's not, again, it neutralizes this whole idea of forbidden food. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
So one of the biggest social, you know, conversations that we're having right now is about the, you know, like I said, the quote-unquote childhood obesity epidemic. What are your thoughts about the focus on child overweight, as you phrase it? What do you think the possible dangers of focusing on this, both in schools and at homes, is for children?
Well, in my experience, becoming hysterical about child overweight is the single biggest causative factor of child overweight. It creates an iatrogenic condition, and do you know the word iatrogenic?
I've heard it, but maybe our listeners need it.
It's like physician-induced or treatment-induced. I think the narrow mean is physician, meaning is physician-induced, but in this case it's sort of hysteria-induced, policy-induced, attitude-induced. But the and what happens is that parents, health professionals, policymakers, and parents misinterpret children's normal size and shape. If you have a big kid, if you have a big baby, and the research and the sort of policy direction right now is saying if your child is big at birth or before 3 months of age, then, you know, the risk is very high that this child will be fat. So, you know, parents panic, understandably, and they start to restrict the child. And the child becomes food preoccupied, and eats as much as they can whenever they can. And I've just seen so many children where, you know, their big parents restrict them, their growth dips for the first few months, and then when they get to the point of being toddlers, when they're relentless anyway, they become really relentless about food, and the toddler gets the upper hand with the parent. The parent just can't withhold, you know, can't be as persistent about withholding food as the toddler is about sort of trying to get it, and the child then actually does eat too much because he's afraid he's going to have to go hungry. He eats too much, and weight starts to accelerate, and, you know, and unless something is done to correct that struggle over feeding, that is, unless a division of responsibility is restored, then the child starts to gain weight at that point and continues gaining weight, really, throughout his growing up years. Gaining too much weight. It's natural for the child to gain weight, but I'm talking about too much weight gain.
So you think that when they have these research studies that say, you know, a fat baby or a fat toddler is going to become a fat adult, you think that it's the research is basically reporting on the phenomenon of that iatrogenic cause?
I certainly do suspect that. Yes, I do. And I also think that in many cases, the research study, and it might not even be that bad, that if there's no interference, if it's just an observational study, as I have read the studies that I have felt, that what the researchers are doing is over-interpreting obesity. They are classifying large children as being too fat, and then saying, you know, large children of large adults, and then they're saying these kids grow up to be too fat. Well, you know, that's just natural growth. Big babies have a tendency to be big children who in turn grow up to be big adults. And so what's the abnormality in that? With all this hysteria, what is normal, kind of at the normal extremes, is being labeled abnormal, and people are getting hysterical about it.
We'll return to our interview with Ellyn Satter here in a minute, where I'll have a little free therapy to ask her questions about my family. In the meantime, I'd just like to pay tribute to a friend of all children, Gamera.
Let's go, Gamera!
Gamera! Gamera! Gamera is really neat. Gamera is filled with meat. We've been eating Gamera! Shell, teeth, eyes, flames, claws, breath, scales, fun!
Dr. Forrester is kind of a jerk, and Frank is really dumb, too.
We have to take part in these lame experiments.
But do we complain?
No.
No.
Yes.
Huh? So we hike him all over the place.
And talk of a thousand wonderful days.
Everybody now.
Gamera is really sweet. He is filled with turtle meat. Now we have commercial sign.
Now I want to play devil's advocate for a minute. Try and see what you think of. I just read David Kessler's The End of Overeating. Have you had a chance to read that?
Parts of it.
Okay. Mainly I want to talk about the self-regulation in children. He cites the work of Susan Johnson, who found that in 1980s, children ages 2 to 4 were compensating for 90% of extra calories, while in the 90s, they were only compensating for about 45% of those calories. Same thing with 5-year-old girls. She found that after drinking a high-calorie beverage, they reduced consumption to compensate for 80% of the extra calories. But by age 8, they were only compensating for 60%, and age 11 was 30%. So what do you think why are they finding these decreases in compensation, both over time and over age?
Well, for one thing, that research has not been published. I don't know where Kessler got it. Mm-hmm. He must have talked to Susan Johnson. in order to come up with those figures. But the, you know, at age 3, I think she looked at preschoolers and or preschoolers and school age children. I mean, the youngest she looked at was age 4 or 5 years. Already, kids at that age have had their internal regulation undermined by too much interference or too little support from their parents, that the division of responsibility in feeding has been broached by parents who, you know, are not consistent about providing regular meals and snacks on the one hand, which is frightening for children, and it tends to create food preoccupation in much the same way that outright food restriction creates food preoccupation, or parents interfering with the amount and type of food that children actually choose at the meal. And so when that happens, kids tend to eat not in accordance with their own hunger and satiety, but in accordance with information coming from the parent. And part of that information is making, you know, unlimited foods and beverages available. And so, you know, if you have a child, and you know, this putting Susan's research in the context, in the broader context, there's other research that indicate that when children are restricted, either with amount or type of food, they do tend to overeat when food is available. And so I think what Susan is looking at in her studies is children who are being fed in a restrained fashion. Yeah. And so, you know, this isn't a natural pattern, but one that has been created by distortions in feeding.
Well, but what about the differences between the 1980s and the 1990s? Why would, I mean...
Well, let's just think about what the difference is between the 80s and 90s with respect to preoccupation with obesity.
True.
With respect to the consistency of family meal times. Mm-hmm. You know, there are just big differences between those two times. In fact, I'm working on revising my Feeding with Love and Good Sense videotapes. Mm-hmm. Those were published originally in 1987, and my viewers are saying, you know, look, these are getting a little long in the tooth, you know, mm-hmm. The TVs are wrong, the hairstyles are wrong. The kids are still right. But, you know, it's all the trappings that people tend to criticize. And so I'm remaking them. And we did a lot of videotaping of a lot of families. And the things that I noticed was that parents are real interfering with kids eating. Mm-hmm. That they, you know, they keep after them about eating their vegetables, eating certain amounts and types of food, you know, eat this, eat that, don't eat this, don't eat that. You know, table manners, just it's sort of it's really a relentless litany that many parents use in over-supervising their children at the table, which interferes with kids' ability to, again, regulate their food intake, to know how hungry and full they are. And this, once again, you know, my hypothesis is that parents are pretty interfering, and the research finds the same thing, that research tells us that 80 to 90% of parents will try to get their kids to eat certain amounts and types of food, and that, you know, and they, when the child says they're done, the parent will try to get them to eat a few more bites. Mm-hmm. Which is, you know, very systematically obliterating the child's sensitivity to his or her own hunger and fullness cues and teaching them to eat in accordance with what's available, which is what Susan's research is finding, rather than in accordance with how hungry they are really are. Susan's research is flawed in another way, as is all the current research with respect to food regulation, and that is its short term. They tend to look at regulation over a day or two. Mm-hmm. I don't know of any of these regulation studies that go to as much as a week. Mm-hmm. And you know, the fact is that one regulates over the short term and then corrects errors in regulation over the long term, mm-hmm. over a week or a month. Well, you know from watching your own kids, especially the one who doesn't eat much, I would just bet that sometimes she eats virtually nothing at all, and other times she eats more than you could ever imagine.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Is that true?
Very accurate, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you just can't believe how much these little kids can eat sometimes, and mm-hmm. other times, you know, it's a bite or two. Mm-hmm. And so how would you... If you were doing a research study with that child over a day or two, I mean, what sort of conclusions would you draw?
Right. It would be
either that she ate hugely or that she was capable of living on air.
That's true. So yeah. Are there any studies that you're aware of or any studies in the works that will study the long-term self-regulation of children?
No, I really not. The work... That, you know, so typical in the nutrition and other fields that the old studies get forgotten about. And, you know, it's as if the only thing that's really significant happened in the last two or three years. But, you know, the work that I depend on is some really old work by Jean Mayer, who was, and this goes back to the 50s and 60s. He was a highly respected nutritionist working at Harvard University.
Okay. So one thing I noticed that was missing from your book, because of my circumstances, I want to ask about it, and I know there are other families that are probably interested too. What do you do in a situation when you have a child from two different households, a divorced family? And
yeah.
Let's say one family, let's say, is the Jamie Oliver type. They want to revolutionize their child's eating and, you know, make sure they eat all healthy and very, very hovering kind of attitude. And the other wants to use your approach. How do you handle that for that kid without, you know, driving him crazy?
So I was. You had me holding my breath there to see if the Jamie Oliver type was going to be the good one, or.
No, I'd say the Jamie Oliver type is the controlling one.
Is a hovering one.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Well, you do try to sort of talk with and work with the other household. I mean, the Jamie Oliver household is certainly entitled to their values about food selection, mm-hmm. you know, to follow their own lights with respect to, you know, what they're comfortable with putting on the table for meals and snacks and so on. And you know, it has its strengths. But they can still follow a division of responsibility in feeding. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are. It's real important that they don't pressure their children to eat this healthy food that they want, or become hysterical when their kids don't eat their broccoli. And so, yes, I mean that this sort of careful extreme of food selection is certainly is legitimate. However, it's real important that those parents do not guilt trip their kids when they, you know, have Snapples at the neighbor's house, or where they drink soda when they're at somebody else's house. That the parent is able to matter-of-factly say to the child, you know, I don't buy that stuff because I'm not comfortable with it, but if you want to eat it, if you have the opportunity to have it and you want it, that's entirely up to you.
What about pressuring a child to lose weight?
Bad. Is that part of Jamie Oliver?
I would say that the two kind of go hand in hand, I would assume, yeah.
Yeah, that's scary. Of course, that's really crossing the lines of division of responsibility. And, you know, and certainly being austere about the diet in hopes of getting the child to lose weight is also crossing the lines of division of responsibility. Kids are onto that in a flash. They know when parents have an agenda for them, and And, you know, they're at the very least, they're going to feel really badly about themselves, and at the most, they're going to get into this food preoccupation thing. And, in fact, you start out asking about two different families raising the kid.
Mm-hmm.
So what you're going to see is it's a child, you know, who's being restricted with types of food and probably number of calories because of all this low-calorie food at the one house is going to overcompensate at the other.
Right.
And so if you're just sort of middle of the road and following the esteemed Ellyn Satter approach, you're going to have some of these foods available on a regular basis,
right.
But certainly not throw open the refrigerator door. You know perfectly well that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about structured meals and structured snacks, mm-hmm. and no grazing for food or beverages between times. But at those times, you know, kids are going to eat a lot, and it's going to take them quite a while to stop eating those cookies like there's no tomorrow. And so, you know, the middle-of-the-road family, if you can't arrive at a compromise with the other one, is just going to have to keep being the middle of the road and holding steady and providing a sensible alternative to these children that will allow them to, at some place, you know, sort of manage their eating in a way that is positive for them. And so it's unfortunate, but kids are pretty amazing at being able to accommodate to whoever the grown-up is in their world and to do what's expected of them. And so, is that a mealy-mouth answer, Shannon?
No, but one of the things that's come up with our family is we've recently found out that our son was sneaking food, which worries me, just because...
At your house?
Right, that shows a level of kind of shame and that he's... not satisfied with maybe the amount he's getting, and so we're not really sure how to deal with a child who's sneaking food.
Yeah, how old is he?
He's 10.
Uh-huh. Okay, well, the first round is, of course, figure out what you're going to do, and I'd figure out what he's sneaking, and then I'd make sure that there was plenty of it out on the table.
Mm-hmm.
What is he sneaking?
Treats, mostly, little cupcakes or, you know, Twinkies, whatever we have for a treat around.
Yeah, well, I just make sure those Twinkies and cupcakes show up at snack time and that they show up frequently at snack time and that, you know, that you have as many packages of them as he needs in order to feel satisfied. And I think... yeah, that would be the plan. And then I'd talk with him about it and say, you know, I've noticed this, and I just want you to know that I don't feel it's necessary for you to, that I want you to have as you know, as many of these foods as you want, that at our house it's really not necessary to sneak in order to get them because we just have them. That's not a problem. And so what kind of foods do you feel you want to eat that we're not having? Let's just arrange to have those.
Okay.
And, and of course, he'll say, well, you know, Mama and Jeremy or whatever don't want me to have those foods. And you can say, well, you know, some people do feel that way. And that's one of the things about having two different families. You know, one family feels one way and one feels the other. And so why don't you just go along with them when they're at their house, and then when you're here, we'll just see to it that we have those. And, of course, you're going to have to tell Mom and Jeremy about it, too, because they're going to become hysterical.
Right.
And just tell them, okay, well, this is what we're doing. Here's why we're doing it. Here's what the research says about forbidden food, and if you look in my books, I think I've got some good research on that.
I've got a list of quotes here I was going to run through, but I'll put them in the podcast at the end here.
Right. And so, it's complicated, isn't it? Please do not interpret anything I say to mean that this is an easy thing to deal with, because it's just not.
Right. Well, we've come up against the end of our interview here, time. Again, Ellyn Satter, Secrets of Feeding a Healthy Family, as well as Your Child's Weight, Helping Without Harming. Awesome books, must reads for all parents. I absolutely love them, and I'm so grateful for you for writing them and helping reassure myself and parents and my wife and parents everywhere that they're doing all right, that they don't need to freak out too much.
That's just great. Well, thank you so much. And I have to congratulate, or I want to congratulate you for your work as well. I know that people really depend on your sensible and accepting approach to deal with all this craziness about weight.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
You're welcome.
Well, have a great weekend, and thank you very much for the interview.
You're welcome. Bye,
bye
now.
I hope you enjoyed the interview, and please be sure to join us at FierceFatties.com for all the post-interview analysis.
Anyway, he got his start getting cigarettes for Agnes DeMille, if you can believe that. But anyway, back to my original story, which was that it seems that Oscar Hammerstein spent 2 weeks up at his Buck County farm writing the lyrics to Oh, What a Beautiful Morning. And he labored over it, and then he turns it over to Dick Rogers, who sits down and promptly, in 10 minutes, mind you, writes the melody. And I don't have to tell you two gentlemen that American musical theater was never quite the same thing.
What a wonderful story.
Tell us that story about Cole Porter again.
Oh, please.
Should I? Yeah. Really? Okay, well, Cole Porter, during his horse riding accident, while he was laying in the middle of the woods with his legs crushed, yelling for help, he decided to write At Long Last Love.
Oh, no!
That's a true story, but what a lot of people don't know is that the lyrics were altered for its Broadway opening, yes. And the original lyrics went something like this. Very tender. Oh, my God, I'm in so much pain. Somebody please help me. Somebody come and save me.
What an enchanting anecdote.
They don't write them like that anymore, do they?
Certainly do not.
How does the Gamera theme song stack up against songs from yesteryear?
Oh, well, it's interesting that you ask that, because the opening lyric of the Gamera song has sort of a Rodgers and Hart feel to it. Let me show you what I mean. Gamera. Gamera. Is really neat. Gamera is filled with meat. We all love you, Gamera. But then the second part is a little more fun. It has sort of a George and Ira Gershwin feel to it. Shell, teeth, eyes, claws, scales, breath, fun. It sort of sneaks up on you. Boo, it says. Gamera's enchantment still grows. Our hearts with love. Gamera's the latest thing. He fills our hearts with spring, spring, spring. Anytime you want some moonbeams, Gamera is the thing. Gamera is really neat. He is filled with turtle meat. We all love you,
Kill him. Better yet, I'll kill him. You push the button.